Yoldaşlar, comrades. I am very happy and moved to be again in Istanbul at home to speak to our brothers and sisters from the other side of the Aegean and to bring to you the warmest fraternal greetings both from my party, EEK, the Workers' Revolutionary Party of Greece, as well from all the Greek workers and oppressed people who look to you as brothers and sisters and not as enemies as the rulers of our countries try to present. Comrades, it is a strange coincidence that every time I speak here, some Greek state official also visits your country. 2 years ago, when I spoke in the same hall, it was another state official who visited Turkey. And this time, probably you know that a few days ago, the Greek Prime Minister, Tsipras, a fake left, visited also your country and has discussions with your President Erdogan. Now, our talk to you has nothing to do with the diplomatic hypocrisy of state officials who say lies. They speak in the name of peace by preparing war. The war of the rich against the poor. And they will try to turn that to a war of all the poor of the world against the rich, against the big capital in both countries and all over the world. When I see and hear all of you in this hall, I feel really that I am at home. When I heard this morning the comrades workers from the two struggles speaking, it is really the same struggle that we wage. It was the struggle of workers against the yellow unions for a real unionize in this country. This week, next Saturday, will be a demonstration in Athens precisely on the same issue. To have real rank and file combative unions against the bureaucracy and the yellow unions fighting for wages and jobs against the barbarity, against the jungle and the hell that our people live, particularly the last 10 years after the bankruptcy of our country. Or I was specially moved by the word of the worker who said that we have to prepare a better world, the future of our children. Really, our struggle is not only for today. We are coming from the future to fight in today, and from this point of view, we celebrate also the revolutionary past, including the 100 years of the Comintern. We celebrate today these 100 years from the founding of the Communist International, because we celebrate and we remain faithful to 100 years of internationalism in action, not in words, but a century of real fights with a lot of tragedy, victories and defeats. But despite the defeats and despite the tragedies, we are here to continue the struggle of all those who gave their life dedicated to this cause of the liberation of humankind. Particularly in this centenary, we, together with the celebration of the Comintern Foundation, we commemorate with a lot of respect, love and dedication the martyrs of our movement, particularly Rosa Luxemburg and Karl Liebknecht, who were murdered by the Freikorps, the precursors of the Nazis, under the orders of Social Democrats, of the Second International. So it is not this kind of international which sends murderers to kill workers' leaders that we fight. On the contrary, the Comintern, the Third Communist International, was founded against the social traitors, against all these so-called reformists who do the dirty work of the bosses. Their struggle is more actual today than ever before. As previous speakers already said, we live a tremendous world crisis, not only a world crisis, really. Capitalism, in its bankruptcy, now enters a new phase of crisis. All the world situation is changing. In the last meeting in Davos, for example, all the bourgeois elites of the world were completely pessimistic what will happen in the next period. And they are preparing new attacks against us. So we have to prepare ourselves also, not just for defense, but for counterattack against them. And this time we know very well that, that we can win. We can win, definitely. Look, they are threatening us with war. Already you have the Middle East. It's a volcano of war. Syria, all the area. And in the last State of the Union speech by Donald Trump, Trump threatened one country after another with all kinds of attacks. He threatened, of course, Venezuela. He threatened Iran. He threatened all the oppressed peoples of the area. But he threatened Russia. And all the preparations of war go in every country. And we face a danger who now goes from military conflicts in the South China Sea to the Mediterranean, from Central Asia to the Balkans. Because my comrade from Macedonia made it very clear, and from Serbia, that the last decision around the name of Macedonia, it had nothing to do about that. It had to make Macedonia a member of NATO, and of the European Union, but mainly of NATO, as they will do with Montenegro and all the Western Balkans, to complete the encirclement of the former Soviet Russia from the Balkans to Azerbaijan, to the Caucasus. And Ukraine already, it is the preface, the prologue of what will happen. They are coming back, these new treaties of NATO in our area, in the Balkans. It is a continuation of the tragedy which started by the attack of NATO to destroy Yugoslavia. We still pay tribute to the Yugoslav revolution to unite the peoples of this area. And the imperialism always wanted, despite all the things, to destroy it. I had the comrade from Belgrade speaking about the meeting in Belgrade, and I remember that my party was present in Belgrade during the bombing of NATO in an act of solidarity to your people against the NATO. It was one of the worst things that happened. We lived in a hotel by the River Sava, and nearby it was a maternity hospital. And they destroyed the hospital in the time when the women were delivering. This is barbarism. They started this from the collapse of the Soviet Union, etc., until now. The war of Yugoslavia was one important and first military step to destroy, not only to pulverize Yugoslavia and the Balkans, but move forward to recolonize all the former Soviet space. And the decision by Trump to cancel the nuclear weapons treaty and to start again a nuclear arms race really generate a lot of new dangers. We cannot stay just in the pacifist way to say, no, we are for peace against the war. We have to wage war against war. This we can do only in together, not one by one. We can start small, in a small scale, as the revolutionaries in Zimmerwald and Kiental in 1915 and 1916, they started. Because the Third International not just started the 2nd of March 1919. It started in really the beginning for the fight for the international. It was during the war by a minority of revolutionaries. Not with a victorious country as it was after the October Revolution. It was the source of the Comintern. It was, of course, the October Revolution, but not only that. It was the war. Don't forget that even before the founding of the Third International, in May, for example, 1917, the Bolsheviki, they demonstrated in Petrograd, in Moscow, in other places, with the slogan, long live the Third International. It was not yet founded. But it came out of this struggle against imperialist war and barbarism. And we have today this imperialist war threats and barbarism in an even greater scale than that humanity knew during the Great War, the First World War, and even the Second World War. So, wars and revolutions are shaping our future in this epoch. It is the essence of this epoch, which quite correctly by Lenin was called an epoch of wars and revolutions. They thought that, okay, wars we can have, but no revolutions. And they celebrated in 1991 the end of history and the end of communism. And the communists, we are here to celebrate the 100th year of the Comintern, of the Communist International, against them. And in the place of an end of history, we have the worst crisis in the history of capitalism today. For the last 10 years, they did all the efforts to find a solution, a way out. They did not find any way out. And now we've gone in a new phase, even worse, of crisis. For this reason, you have all these political barbaric acts. You cannot separate in a mechanical way the economic from the political. Today we have everywhere a tremendous global crisis. At the same time, in one country after another, particularly in Europe, but in America as well, of a regime crisis. Or they cannot govern as in the past. Even you take America, the biggest, the strongest imperialist country in the world. There is the first time that you have the president to be in conflict with the CIA and the FBI. Or the ruling class of America is split. And all the institutions are in a low intensity for the moment, civil war among themselves. Why? It's not just a division among the upper class. Something happens in the depth of society. The most important, probably, element in the State of the Union speech by Trump the 5th of February, a few days ago, it was not just the threat against Venezuela, against Iran, etc., or Russia. The most important, in my view, It was the point, one point when he said, we have to sound the alarm about the danger of socialism in America. And they said, we renew our resolve that America never will be a socialist country. Look, during all the Cold War, the threat of socialism was the Soviet Union. They say all the U.S. president after U.S. president, the State of the Union speeches, they said, oh, boo, the problem, the communist threat, etc., all the Reds were coming to the West. Now, no. Now they see the danger of communism because in the socialist, in the American political language, socialism means communism, okay? This danger can come inside the citadel, the center of global capitalism. It is not just a rhetorical phrase. We have to take seriously this point. It is a question of weakness. They have a crisis of power to control society everywhere. This is, in my view, what I saw personally too in the occasion of the Gilets Jaunes, of the Yellow Vests, the comrades of Rohr and other comrades mentioned from this point. I had the chance or the opportunity to participate in two demonstrations, Act 10 and Act 11. And if you participate, you see from directly, because the mass media say all the lies you can imagine. They speak only now, after so many weeks, 12 weeks, about the people who lost their eyes, their arms, the dead, etc., etc. The repression in France today is worse than ever before the last 50, 60 years. Much worse than May 68 or 95 or in other occasions. Why? Why is that? I think despite this, when they said that we are apolitical, the Gilets Jaunes was not a, it is the most political movement you can imagine. If the principal slogan today, it is Macron démission, down with the president, okay, of the country, what is more political? And others, when they question the disintegrating bourgeois parliamentary democracy, and they try to improvise an alternative to that. We saw that in Greece 10 years ago. In the first phase of the struggles produced by the world crisis, in Greece, Spain, Egypt, Tunisia, etc., they thought that with the end of this first wave of struggles, after the capitulation of Syriza in Greece, Podemos in Spain, etc., etc., after the hell in Syria and the military coup in Egypt, that they finished. They did not finish. Already in the opening of this meeting, Comrade Nash spoke a lot about a lot of revolts of the last year. We have a new wave, a second phase. The Gilets Jaunes is one important aspect of that. But apart, take another example which in my view is very important to look. Not so much publicized as France, but very important. Hungary. Look, until now everybody thought that the Orban far-right nationalist regime, he was the most stable. A few months ago he had a landslide victory in the elections, the third victory. Everybody thought it was more stable apparently than Poland, for example, where you have some social movements there. In Hungary, nothing. And suddenly, with this law of slavery, with the extending of ours, Comrade Daniela from Bulgaria spoke about that, you have an uprising. Budapest was crowded by people, workers. It's the difference with France in one sense. The working class was in the forefront. The petty bourgeois came also, and the intellectuals. They occupied the bridge between Buda and Pest. They put under siege the radio television building. Then the parliamentarians came to speak, okay, to the TV and say their solidarity to the people. Even they won a big victory in the Audi car factory with a rise of the wage 18%. The Germans have to give them, otherwise they lose everything. The traditional base of the Orban regime was the countryside. Budapest was more liberal or left-wing. But this time it was together with Budapest is the countryside where all these factories of the German capitalists are implanted. You have blockades in the motorways. You had occupations of factories. Where? In the most stable, far-right, ultra-nationalist country in Central Europe. It is important what Daniela from Bulgaria said here, that the same law is extended now in Bulgaria, which shows that it was not an exception, a Hungarian exception. They lose the game in Eastern Europe, including the Balkans. So they have to move to impose to us the worst slavery conditions to survive. It is a hot area, our region. And never before was more actual the slogan of all the revolutionaries in this region, starting from the 15th century, then with Rigas, or later on, in the period of the Communist International, the slogan for a Balkan Socialist Federation. The partisans during the Second World War, in Yugoslavia, in Greece, in Albania, in Bulgaria even, in one part of it, they had a central slogan, the formation of this federation. A speaker before mentioned Kapitan Kemal, Mary Bailey, I think the name, the Turkish revolutionary, who organized a Balkan brigade in Greece during the civil war against the Anglo-American imperialists and the Greek bourgeoisie. It was a Balkan brigade with Greeks, Turks, Macedonians, Bulgarians, Gypsies, you name it. All the population of our peninsula. But this revolution, unfortunately, was betrayed. And we have to commemorate not only 100 years from the founding of this revolutionary international, but as well 100 years of tragedies and epic victories and a lot of bitterness as well. Because, of course, history did not end in 1991, but there is a lot of historical disorientation until now. This, we have to do a lot against the discredit of the left and of the communists, which discredited. They present us as Stalinists. Well, Stalinism is finished anyway. You can't speak about the name of Stalin, Stalinist, but we are in a new period. We have to look forward what to do to that. And we have a lot to do. And we cannot have, everybody can accept and everybody even speaks from different point of view about the need of international. But what kind? What international? That's a big point. We cannot have an international with historical amnesia by forgetting what happened the last 100 years. We will forget or forgive the murderers of Rosa Luxemburg and Liebknecht. We'll put our future to social democracy or to the remnants of small Stalinist party who celebrate the past. They are distinct nothing from this past. So among them there are real communists, I agree. And we have fight against any political nihilism who says that these 100 years passed for nothing. No. Socialism it does not equal with gulags. Socialism, it is the only road for liberation of humanity. We had a lot of victims in this fight. We saw monstrosities during the century. Okay. But we don't give up. Socialism and communism are not equal with gulags. It is the only future for humanity. There is no other. And I can tell that in our region and in our continent, look, our region, it is in the door of the Middle East. It is Europe. It is the soft underbelly of Russia. All the world contradictions are here. And Europe, what Europe? The European Union is disintegrating. You had the Eurozone crisis, the bankruptcy of Greece, then you had the Brexit and the chaos after Brexit. You had now an attempt when Macron was elected to rebuild the axis of the European Union, which is France and Germany. And Macron was asked by the German bourgeoisie, not only the French, that to give the proofs that he can do the job by attacking, first of all, the French working class. And he attacked the French working class, most viciously than anybody before him. That's true. And he thought that thanks to the trade union bureaucrats that he succeeded. But then came the unexpected revolt, more even revolutions, does not come with a date. I come that date in that hour. Come always unexpected. And you have to be, what you have to do, it is to prepare consciously for that moment. Because many of the revolutions were lost because of unpreparedness. Next month there will be a celebration in Hungary, by the way, again in Budapest, of the centenary of the Hungarian Revolution of the Workers' Councils, which a very heroic revolution, but unprepared. And also, I mean, they did the totally contrary to what Lenin did. They dissolved the Communist Party inside the Social Democratic Party. And then other things, we have no time to go to that. So you can lose a revolution out of unpreparedness. In Greece, we lost revolutionary occasions both by betrayal and as well by unpreparedness. By betrayal, in the 40s, Greece knew the partisan war against the Nazis was the birth of a social revolution in Greece. But Greece in the Yalta Treaty was given to the West, were betrayed. We lost the revolution despite the absolute, all the Greece was liberated by the partisans. And we lost it. And you had decades of concentration camps, of execution squads, with the repression, even before the military dictatorship of 67-74. And now we are in a turning point in Greece, will be, many speak about the elections of May, but the elections will be an episode towards an even more brutal confrontation between the hostile social forces. And will mark all the other developments in the Balkans, by the way. What Macron's failure in front of the social uprising of the region,
I feel, you have five.
It is, that means that the effort to rebuild the Franco-German axis of the European Union is lost, is defeated, is failed. The Fifth Republic in France is just a ghost of the past. The post-Merkel Germany, where the Nazis are the official opposition, the AfD, in the parliament, what it is. So all Europe is destabilized. Middle East is a volcano. In the eastern borders of Europe you have a war. In Ukraine, I mean. A hybrid one, but you have. So you have all this in front of us. So we have to build an international which both looks to the future, comes from the future, is not sectarian, is not opportunist, but at the same time embodies all the lessons of the last century, and is on this basis that we say that the new international should be the fourth international, not out of Trotsky's narrow-minded, but for us, the fourth international was founded in 1938, not just against Stalin and Stalinism. It was founded to complete the work of the October Revolution. We are communists. We leave the sheer anti-Stalinism to the Democrats. We are communists. As a communist, we are fourth internationalists in the sense we fight for international which complete on the world scale. Our fatherland, which we defend foremost, is the international and world socialism.